Hey, it's Testosterone RN, and I got a great video for you today. This video is going to be very important for preppers and for non-preppers. Really, the information in this video, the topic of this video, is going to affect everybody worldwide, and pretty severely in the next 20 to 30 years, if what they're predicting is correct. And I think it's interesting to see, even in the next 10 years, what's going to happen, based on what I'm already seeing at this point. And we'll see how the healthcare industry combats this going forward. Anyhow, the reason this video is important to preppers is because a lot of times preppers stockpile antibiotics because they're thinking of infectious disease and how can they stop that? You know, when it all hits the fan and there's no framework anymore for the nation, how are we going to supply antibiotics? How are doctors going to prescribe them? How are we going to even produce them or find them? So I understand the rationale completely. It makes sense. But based on what I'm going to tell you today, you might change your mind, you might not, but I'm going to give you the information and we'll go from there. So with that being said, what is antimicrobial resistance? So what is antimicrobial resistance? Well, antimicrobial resistance is the development of resistance to antibiotics that microorganisms acquire over time through exposure to antibiotics and certain evolutionary processes. There's a lot of things that confer and help bacteria become immune or resistant to antibiotics. This process generally happens over time, gradually becoming resistant to multiple drugs. And you'll hear this acronym a lot, MDRO, multi-drug resistant organisms. Now, I'm going to throw a lot of acronyms at you throughout this video, some bigger words that you might not have heard before, but I know you guys are smart. I'm not going to talk down to you guys like you're stupid, bring you up to speed. So that way, when this stuff really starts hitting the fan, you know, in the next few years, and you start hearing about it more on the news and whatnot, you'll know exactly what they're talking about. So that being said, let's go right on. And we're talking about certain evolutionary processes, and it's important. What's important to know about bacteria is, man, these boogers are awesome when it comes to evolution. Okay, they're not like us. With humans, what, about 18 years old on average to 25 is how long, you know, the typical person's waiting, at least in America, if I had to guess, before they start having kids, right? And then you maybe have two or three, and you're done. And then you have to, those kids have to wait another 18 to 25 years before they have a family, blah, 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 blah. Okay? Well, with bacteria, there's binary fission. And that's the asexual reproduction of bacteria. It's also known as the replication rate or the doubling rate. The reason it's called a doubling rate is because it's the amount of time it takes for a group of bacteria or a colony or whatever you want to call it to double in size. So if you imagined the room you're in half full of bacteria, the doubling time or doubling rate is how long it would take for the rest of that room to become completely full if it was proportional on all sides, all things being equal. Okay, so typically with binary fission, the average replication or binary fission rate is 40 to 60 minutes for bacteria. Okay, so think about the room you're in, half full of bacteria, and then 40 to 60 minutes, so no longer than an hour, that room is completely full. That's how fast they replicate. All right, other bacteria like Staph aureus, you've heard of Staph aureus, you've probably heard it in the form of MRSA, methicillin resistant Staph aureus, is, and some salmonella, I believe also, is like 20 to 30 minutes. Okay, and those are common bacteria that cause food poisoning because it doesn't take long for them to get to numbers that can make you sick just by the food sitting out for 20, 30 minutes. So this rate of replication is what enables bacteria to pass on resistance so quickly to their progeny. So because of this, we have to be very careful about what we're doing in the medical field when it comes to the use of antibiotics. Where are we now and when will it happen? Right, so the World Health Organization and the CDC report that right now, worldwide, there's about 700,000 deaths attributed to antibiotic-resistant infections or antimicrobial-resistant infections. And as far as when will it happen, well, that's kind of a trick question, I guess, because it's already happening, right? And we've actually been seeing this for years, and it's just becoming more and more severe every year. But now they see the writing on the wall, and they know how serious it is. I see multi-drug-resistant organisms all the time, but I'm sure the severity is going to pick up in the next couple decades, so we'll see. But as far as what the World Health Organization, the CDC, say is, looking at the data from both of them, is that by about 2050, so about 30 years from now approximately, the worldwide deaths attributed to antimicrobial-resistant infections are going to be 10 million. So you're going from 700,000 worldwide to 10 million deaths a year worldwide in a span of 33 years. So that's pretty serious. To compare it to other diseases, chronic diseases like cancer causes 8 million deaths a year. And what's interesting about that is that cancer is a disease where people use chemotherapy to treat the disease. And chemotherapy actually can attack your immune system, so to speak, leaving your body vulnerable or immunocompromised. And when you do that, of course, you're more susceptible to infections. Really interesting to see how the health industry is going to handle this in the next 10 years. So what does this mean for the healthcare industry, for humankind? I mean, if you're a prepper, you might be looking at more than the healthcare industry, and you can take all the information I'm giving you and extrapolate it and apply it critically to whatever circumstances you're thinking about. But what does it mean? So the rise of superbug bacteria or pan-resistant bacteria. Pan-resistant means bacteria that are resistant to all antibiotics or antimicrobials. This has serious implications and consequences for healthcare. We talked a little bit about cancer and chemotherapy, but there's other things that's going to affect also. So a lot of surgeries nowadays we're able to do because of prophylactic antibiotic use. All right, knee replacements, hip replacements, cardiovascular surgeries, you know, all the open heart stuff, neuro, all that. A lot of prophylactic antibiotics given to prevent infection from occurring during the surgery. So if you get a bug in you that's resistant to all those antibiotics, well, then it doesn't even matter what they give you before surgery. Unless your body can fight it off, you're probably going to succumb to your infection and pass. An increase in hospital-acquired infections. All right, so as these bugs become more and more resistant, they're going to be able to be spread more because there's going to be more of them. The proliferation is probably going to be extreme unless we really start to get a grasp on the situation. Increased risk for the immunocompromised. So we've talked about cancer, right? We talked about the chemo, how it knocks out the immune system, leaving you vulnerable and susceptible to infection. But you also have other people with autoimmune diseases such as HIV, and there's some others I'm not going to list here as well. But HIV, right, they have a compromised immune system. That's going to be pretty bad. And then organ transplantation, right? A lot of people take immunosuppressants after organ transplantation to keep their body from rejecting the new organ. So that might pose some risks. And also along with that, what a lot of people might not know is that a lot of people who have organ transplants actually can acquire forms of cancer as well. So that's kind of like a double whammy. So not good. So basically, if we get to a situation where we're dealing with a majority of bacteria that are pan-resistant, resistant to everything we can throw at them, we're going back to pre-30s, 1930s medicine. I mean, I think Alexander Fleming discovered penicillin in 1928, if I'm not mistaken, somewhere around there at least. And we're going to go back to an era of medicine before that. Okay, so why is this happening? Well, there's many reasons, so we'll just start going down the list. So overprescribing of antibiotics by physicians for fear of complaint by the patient that the physicians aren't doing what they're supposed to. Basically, the physician doesn't think the patient needs antibiotics. The patient complains or threatens them and pressures the physician into giving antibiotics, and that pressure's there for people to receive antibiotics when really nothing's when that's not necessary that they receive those antibiotics. This next one I think is going to be pretty big in the prepper community, if I had to bet. So patients not completing their full course of antibiotics. This is a really important aspect to how bacteria acquire antibiotic resistance. So I think what's happening is people are taking their antibiotics and then they start to feel better and I say, okay, well, I guess I don't need them anymore. And so they don't take the full course for as long as they're supposed to. And some people might throw it away. I think some preppers are probably saving the last couple pills and saying, okay, well, I'm just going to keep saving up and saving up every time I'm sick, and then eventually I'll have a nice little store or cachet of antibiotics for when it all hits the fan. The problem with this is that you're not taking it long enough to kill all the bacteria entirely, and the stronger ones are going to survive. And that's basically how antibiotic resistance happens in one way. Going along with that, so the wrong antibiotic might be prescribed by the physician or the provider. The wrong route of administration. So not all things taken orally are going to cure your infection. Some things have to be given topically or intravenously, or sometimes they need to be taken orally versus the others. It just depends on the infection and the type of bacteria. Also the wrong dose and duration for the specific pathogen. So duration, again, not completing your full course of antibiotics or not being prescribed a course long enough to effectively kill whatever pathogen is infecting you. Another big one for the medical industry is proliferation through bad hygiene practices. Making sure that we're hand hygiening and being compliant with hand hygiene and isolation protocols, personal protective equipment, also known as PPE, when people are in isolation. But this is also really important at the home, too. If you're not hygienic, if you're not practicing good oral hygiene, taking showers, if you're not washing your hands before you eat or after you use the restroom, before you touch your eyes, or your nose, or your mouth, the chances of you becoming sick are greatly increased. And in an era of antibiotic resistance, you're going to proliferate those antibiotic resistance organisms even more than they are currently being proliferated. So every time you become infected, that organism now has another chance for you, for someone to go to the doctor, you get antibiotics, you take the antibiotics, you don't finish the course, right? They become resistant to the antibiotic. Then you cough on your hand, hey, how you doing? You pass it on to someone else, they touch their eye, man, my eye itches, and now they got some infection, and they had to go get antibiotics, but the one before won't cure it. Now they need another type of antibiotic to treat that infection because that bacteria has become resistant. And that's a very simple way of explaining it, but that's basically one of the ways antibiotic resistance can occur. Let's see, foreign country policy. So countries, I believe India has an over-the-counter antibiotic program. So much like you would buy Tylenol in the pharmacy, they can buy certain antibiotics over-the-counter, which obviously leads to self-prescribing of antibiotics, and you get the wrong course, wrong dose, so on and so on, which we already talked about. And then other evolutionary processes. So we talked about binary fission already, right? The way these, or the how fast these things can replicate and become resistant. So really there's three ways, okay? So the first way we discussed, you take your antibiotics, you don't finish them, and then you've killed off all the weaker bacteria, but some of the stronger ones that didn't die right away, okay, they're still left. Okay, so now they go through this binary fission and none of the weaker bacteria are there for them to compete with, for resources with, and they just replicate like crazy, and you got a bunch of bacteria that are all tougher now, that are more resistant than the previous were. And then as that keeps happening, you see how the bacteria are able to become more and more resistant as they progress, and obviously their evolution is way faster than humans, so it's completely feasible by that, by 2050, we're going to see huge problems in the healthcare industry because of this if we don't do something now. Some of the other evolutionary processes. So bacteria are not like humans. They can pass their DNA horizontally. So vertical transmission would be like if I pass my genes on to my son, okay? Horizontal transmission would be like if I pass my genes on to my best friend. Because I have blue eyes and I pass my gene on, now he has blue eyes, okay? So they can pass their DNA on to other bacteria, all right, leaving pieces of DNA behind, like plasmids, that other bacteria can come and pick up. So E. coli, some E. coli might die and their plasmids are left behind, and other E. coli can come and pick up that gene, envelop it, and encode it into their DNA, and now they're resistant to whatever that other E. coli was resistant to. But more than that, it doesn't have to just be like one species to another, to the same species. It could be different. So E. coli can be resistant to a certain antibiotic, and then it dies, leaves its plasmids behind, and a Klebsiella pneumoniae comes up and picks up that plasmid. Now that Klebsiella pneumoniae is just as resistant to that antibiotic as the E. coli was, and so that's another way. And then the third way, viruses. So viruses, there's certain viruses called bacteriophage, and bacteriophage can come and actually infect the bacteria. So they infect the bacteria, like E. coli or Klebsiella, Pseudomonas, whatever, right? And when they infect that bacteria and they leave, they'll pull out some of that bacteria's DNA and go to another bacteria. It doesn't have to be the same species. And go to like a, from an E. coli to a Klebsiella or a Serratia or Salmonella or something like that and infect it. And now that bacteria has that same level of resistance as the other bacteria, just as if it was picking up pieces of plasmids, the DNA that I was talking about. So these are special organisms. They have great ability to become resistant to antibiotics. Okay, so what you're seeing here is what I envisioned in my mind's eye. I created this so you get a better visual of what I'm thinking. So this is the healthcare evolutionary cycle of antimicrobial resistance. Top left, you can see someone's infected by a bacteria. They go to be treated by a physician, personal care provider, and they use these limited resources, antibiotics, to treat the infection. As the individual is being treated, the bacteria are exposed to this antibiotic, potentially developing resistance. And as they're not killed completely off, the patient's still not free from infection yet, they're contacted by a healthcare worker, or this could be in your home, and someone at home is in contact with you. And no one's practicing proper hand hygiene compliance. They're not hand washing or hand foaming. If you're in a hospital in isolation and someone's not complying with the proper standards of personal protective equipment and isolation requirements, they become infected, or excuse me, contaminated rather, and their scrubs or clothes or hands now carry this bacteria that you're infected with that already had the potential to become resistant. And then they go on to the next person and that contaminated clothing or their hands or whatever comes in contact with that person, and they become infected now with this bacteria that's already had the potential of becoming resistant to the current antibiotic it was exposed to. So when you see every time the cycle is completed, if you imagine it, it's more like concentric circles. It's like a downward spiral, I guess you could say that. It's kind of scary to think about. So every time the cycle is completed, it's a downward spiral because these limited resources become more limited than they were the first time. You might not be able to treat with that same antibiotic now because it's developed a resistance to whatever it was exposed to. So the next person has to be treated with a stronger antibiotic or a different antibiotic than the previous. All right, so who can stop antimicrobial resistance? And how do we stop it? All right, so first off, accrediting agencies such as the Joint Commission, they accreditate hospitals. They say in 2017 it's mandatory for all hospitals to have an antimicrobial stewardship team. And in brevity, an antimicrobial stewardship team is a team that promotes the judicious use of antibiotics and looks to stop the proliferation of multi-drug resistant organisms. So there's that. And that's huge. And I serve on an antimicrobial stewardship team with a lot of good people. It's an interdisciplinary team, pharmacists, physicians, infection control, microbiologists, and other staff members throughout the hospital. We're all putting our heads together, looking at the data, looking at evidence-based practice, and coming up with a game plan from there. The biggest solution to this problem, though, is you. So, number one, making sure on the medical side that you're holding physicians, nurses, other medical staff, and hospital staff accountable for hand hygiene compliance. It's the number one way infection spreads, all right? And it's the number one way we can stop infection from spreading. It's the most cost-efficient, the easiest, and the most effective way in combating the transmission of illness, period, let alone multi-drug-resistant organisms. So don't feel embarrassed, whether you're in a clinic or a hospital. If your physician comes in, you absolutely have the right to say, "Hey, I'm sorry, doc, but before we go any further, I would really appreciate it, you know, if you would wash your hands or hand foam in." And you can ask your nurses, radiology technicians, anybody who's coming in your room, make sure you wash your hands. That being said, make sure you wash your own hands, because it doesn't just have to be in the hospital. This can be out in the community, community-acquired as well. So make sure you're washing your hands. Family members are washing their hands. Don't be coughing on your hand to cover your cough. Coughing your elbow instead. That way you're not putting your hands on doorknobs, phones, things like that are going to transmit infection. Very important. If your doctor prescribes you antibiotics, take your antibiotics in their entirety. Finish the full course so that way you don't cause any organisms to be multi-drug resistant. That being said, if you don't, if you're not prescribed antibiotics by your physician, don't pressure your physician into taking them. If there's no need, it could be a viral infection and viruses aren't treated by antibiotics. That doesn't work. So sometimes you just have to let the virus run its course. Other things like influenza, there's Tamiflu for those. It just depends on what you have. Ensure that if you are hospitalized with a multi-drug resistant infection, that the physicians and nurses and the staff are isolating you, and that if you're in isolation, that they are following policy on wearing the proper personal protective equipment to keep from spreading that around the hospital. And if they do it for you, then you know they're doing it for everybody else. And if they're doing it for everybody else, then I know they're doing it for you. So that's important as well. So the other side is political. All right, what I didn't tell you before, a major factor in antimicrobial resistance is the agricultural industry. There's a lot of knowledge on this, so a lot of information out there that you can look up and read about. All right, so in big agriculture, these industries that are these businesses that are pumping out animals by the thousands, right? These animals are in very crowded conditions. Just like if you were a human in very crowded conditions, disease can just spread through the population. So what they're doing is they're just giving a lot of antibiotics to these animals to slow disease transmission. What they noticed, an unintended side effect of some of these antibiotics, like tetracyclines, I believe, is that for whatever reason, it promotes the growth of the animal. They grow faster, and they grow larger. So they can produce bigger animals faster that aren't sick, basically. And so that means more money for them. But what's happening is it's contributing to multi-drug resistant organisms, to antibiotic or antimicrobial resistant organisms. So call your politicians, your representatives, senators, and push for bills and ask about bills that promote judicious use of antibiotics in the agricultural industry. Okay, now it's the good stuff. This is stuff I really like to talk about. And this next line, it makes me laugh because every time I think about this word, I can't help but think of the Three Amigos. If you've seen the movie, you'll know what I'm talking about. So the infamous infectors. They're not famous, they're infamous. You go and watch the movie, you'll know what I'm talking about. Funny stuff. Anyhow, the infamous infectors that you hear about commonly are going to be MRSA, you've probably heard about, and maybe VRSA. So methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, or Staph aureus, and then vancomycin-resistant Staph aureus, so it's progressed to being vancomycin-resistant. There's also multi-drug-resistant Acinetobacter. Typically, that's going to be Acinetobacter baumannii, and then your ESBL producers. We'll get into what ESBL is in a second, and then CRE, and we'll get into what that is in just a second. So ESBLs are extended spectrum beta-lactamase producing bacteria. Okay, you heard the word lactamase, extended spectrum beta-lactamase. Okay, anytime you hear a word with ACE on the end, A-S-E, that means it's an enzyme, and what enzymes do is they are catalysts and compounds that break down things, okay? So, extended spectrum beta-lactamase producing organism, it produces an enzyme, the lactamase, that breaks down beta-lactam antibiotics, and it renders these antibiotics ineffective. And you can have E. coli ESBL, Klebsiella ESBL, all matter, not every bacteria, but a lot of bacteria can be ESBL producers. And then eventually it can progress to where they become CRE, which is carbapenem-resistant Enterobacteriaceae. That's a mouthful, I know. I'll just call it CRE. These are basically very bad bacteria, nightmarish, and they can be resistant to penicillins, fluoroquinolones, cephalosporins, aminoglycosides, tetracyclines, sulfonamides, and these are the bacteria that are promiscuous that can pass their plasmids to other gram-negative bacteria like E. coli to Klebsiella and so on. Let's see. These, according to the CDC, these carry with it a 50% mortality rate in hospitalized patients. Reason being is when you're hospitalized and you have the more comorbidities you have, the more vulnerable you are and compromised you are. And someone who's already has several comorbidities or illnesses or issues that are causing them to be ill have a higher chance of passing away because of an infection with this. Anyhow, 50% mortality rate, these are your gram-negative bacilli, rod-shaped bacteria that naturally colonize the human gut. And, you know, you've heard me talk about E. coli and Klebsiella, but there's many others. There's Shigella species, Salmonella, Yersinia, Enterobacter, Serratia, Proteus, Providencia, Edwardsiella, and Citrobacter. And some of these are pan-resistant, meaning they're resistant to all matter of antibiotics, and it's basically up to your immune system to fight it off, otherwise you'll expire, and there's nothing we can do or anybody can do for you. So we talked about 2050, and what you're probably wondering now is, what will the future bring? All right, well, Nobel laureate Josh Lederberg was quoted as saying the future of humanity and microbes will likely evolve as episodes of our wits versus their genes. I would like to add that it will likely be a matter of our will, integrity, and ethical principles to take the right necessary actions in order to combat antimicrobial resistance. So I hope you found this video useful, informative. You can use it in preparing yourself how you prepare. It might be wise for you, instead of stockpiling antibiotics and to hold them back in case, instead to focus on measures on preventing infection. As I say, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. So obviously you can apply that knowledge farther and say, ounces equal pounds, pounds equal pain, right? So you obviously have to carry less with you, figuratively speaking, the more knowledgeable you are. The other thing that a lot of preppers might not think about is when they're taking these antibiotics, there's certain infections or certain pathogens are treated by different antibiotics, all right? There's gram-positive antibiotics versus gram-negative, and your mycobacterium is kind of like another classic acid-fast bacilli. That's like your tuberculosis or Hansen's disease, if you know what that is. That's leprosy, mycobacterium leprae. Indole-positive and indole-negative bacteria also. So one antibiotic isn't going to kill all these things, especially in a world or an era, rather, of antimicrobial resistance. It might not be wise to stockpile antibiotics because then you can make things even worse. The other thing, and you don't know, if you're not a trained physician, you're not going to know exactly how to treat those antibiotics, what the route, as we talked about earlier, the route, duration, right drug, dosage, and all that stuff to effectively kill it. You can make something way worse on yourself. You could create a super bug in your body that'll wind up killing you when it might not have done that in the first place. So very important that you don't self-prescribe. I can't control you. You're going to do what you want to do. Other things to think about, though, is a lot of these antibiotics have serious side effects. You could really damage your liver or kidneys. You can have, to the point of failure by taking too much of something or something that's not the right thing to take, especially if you have other comorbidities that could exacerbate those situations. Probably not a good idea. What else? So, one more thing to think about, just health in general, right? We talked about hygienic principles. We talked about, I referred you to some of my videos about cleaning and fomites and biofilms and all that. Those are really important to look at. And then self-prescribed medications, we talked about that. But what you might not know is diabetes has serious implications on the effectiveness of your immune system. And when your blood sugar is high, it actually effectively removes your immune system or takes it out of action, so to speak, just in general terms, and makes it not as effective. So with diabetes, it causes vascular and circulation issues as it is already. But then you tie in a compromised immune system, and you see a lot of diabetics who have amputations, particularly in their feet and stuff like that, because of infections. They can't feel that they're injured because their nerves are destroyed, and they get an infection, and then their vascular system's compromised, so they're not getting the blood flow they need, and their immune system is compromised. Big time risk for infection. So another thing to think about is health. If you're truly preparing for an end of the world situation or a hits the fan situation, and you want to be prepared, prepare your body and your mind. Work out, run. I could probably eat a little less myself. Manage your diet and just try and be healthy. So I hope this video presentation was informative to you and you find it useful. This is something that's very, very, very important. I hope you share it with as many people as you can and get the word out there. We can combat antimicrobial resistance. We can stop it or really slow it down so that way future generations also have the benefit of antibiotics. I mean, they are a wonder drug, and they are used for life-saving measures, and they're a wonderful thing, but we're fast approaching an era where we might not have them anymore. So I encourage you to share this video and get the word out there. I put a lot of time and knowledge and effort into this video, and I would really appreciate it, y'all, if you would give me a thumbs up and like this video, and please comment on it. And if you haven't already, please subscribe to my channel. I've got a lot of other great videos on there, and I'm working on a lot of other great videos as well. And I plan on continuing posting once a week to this channel, so you'll always have new videos to check out. In conclusion, I just would like to tell you to stay informed, be prepared.